sister United Methodist churches, you know, as we're singing when we all get to heaven, for the day of rejoicing that will be. One of our sister United Methodist churches on their sign, they had the key to heaven was hung on a nail.
Amen.
Amen.
His name is Jesus Christ. And our gospel this morning, we've been studying the Gospel of John since the beginning of Lent. And it's so clear the way that we find life now and into eternity. We find it in our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I asked Jesus, how much do you love me? He said, this much. And he spread his arms and he died for you and for me. Let's go to John's Gospel. John chapter 20. John's Gospel is just so full of good news for us this morning. Early on, the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in. And he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Amen. Please pray with me. Lord, the Gospel of John is just full of such wonderful good news this morning. Help us to believe in you. Help us to believe on you. Help us to believe through you. Help us to believe by your living in us. Help us to live the good news this morning. It is in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. I was concerned last night. In my introduction, I just went right like into explaining about the gospel and the text, and I didn't have an introduction. And, you know, but God is faithful. And so I realized this morning that when I went to the sunrise service and one of my brother pastors told the story, I realized the Lord said to me, that's your introduction. As one of my brother pastors said after Pastor Tristan Chin from Bethany Lutheran Church preached the message, he said, hey, Tristan, we're going to keep you. Amen. And this is a classic story that's been around for years in many shapes and sizes. But let's start this morning by hearing this. There was a young pastor who was called to a church in the Midwest. And even before he arrived, the former pastor who had been in that church said, brother, I feel sorry for you, because no matter what you do, it ain't going to happen at that church. It's not going to, you can do anything, stand on your head. It's just, that church will not grow. In fact, it's dying. You're not going to be successful. So the young pastor, he just ignored everything that older pastor said. He went there, he worked hard, he visited, he stayed late nights in his office, was there early in the morning. He was faithful. He got, you know, he brought people in from time to time. He did his best. At the end of the year, the first year he was there, he said to himself, that former minister had a point. Because Sunday morning, there were not a lot of people there. People were critical. They were unkind to one another. It just seemed clear that the devil wanted that place shut down. So one Sunday, he got the bright idea, got up there and said, "Next Sunday, we are having a funeral for this church." Now that got their attention. It was like a couple years ago in the Washington County Times, the church closed and they were all upset at the denomination and the diocese for closing it down. And you know, how dare they do that? And they wrote letters to the editor of the Burlington County Times. Like, God knows what they were going to do. But anyway, the people, there was a buzz in this little town. And so the next Sunday, the place is packed. It's full for the funeral service. And you know, people get up and talk about how this church had blessed them and how they were going to be sad that the church was closing and this, that, and the other thing. And you know, the preacher, he had a casket there, an open casket. They had communion, and it was a nice service. And the preacher said, "Before you leave, please come forward and pay your final respects." And the people began to do that. And as they looked into the casket, they saw contorted faces. They saw nasty looks. They just, like, there was a mirror in the casket. And they would look, and they'd file by. But the most profound thing was when the preacher was the last one. At a funeral, I like to be the last one. Wait, places a flower. This is what the preacher did. He looked in that mirror and he said to God, "Not my will, but your will be done." Amen. And that's the key this morning to resurrection. Because if ever a resurrection is going to happen, there's got to be a death. There's got to be a death. That's what we celebrate in baptism. We even do it to babies. But baptism is death and new life. I had a professor in seminary. He told us about a professor he had. Said, "There's one reason for you to miss my test. Death. Yours." Well, there's one way for each of us to experience the resurrection this morning. Death, yours, and mine. It goes like this. "Not my will, but your will be done." Years ago, when Gwen and I first started seminary, the Eastern Baptist Theological Seminary, they brought in this big Baptist muckety-muck preacher. And that's how he ended his sermon. He said, "This is a great way to start anything with God. It's a great way to finish, too. It's a great way to have a good middle, too. God, not my will, but your will be done." We've been studying the Gospel of John since the beginning of Lent. It is filled with good news, and it gives us wonderful instruction on how to live and have a life of abundance. The gospel tells us. Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples. This is chapter 20. Just read some more of this chapter later today. Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. The end of the Gospel of John says that everything Jesus did, if you tried to write it down, the world could not contain the books that would be written. All God's people said, "Wow." You hear that? The world couldn't contain the books if everything was written down that Jesus did. But then John goes, "But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. That through believing, you may have life in his name. Wow. Earlier in the Gospel of John, the religious people say to Jesus, tell us what to do. Tell us what to do this morning. And Jesus says, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. It's like the jailer. Read a couple chapters ahead. It's like the jailer. His worst nightmare has happened. He's got a bunch of people in his prison. He's guarding them literally with his life. If you're a Roman jailer, that's what you do. He's literally guarding them with his life. And an earthquake happens, their shackles fall off, and he's about to take his life, because his way of taking his life would be a lot more gentler than the Romans. Believe me, his bosses, when they find out they all leave, St. Paul yells out, don't do it! We're all here! Nobody's taken off! And the jailer, this tough Roman jailer, you know, he had arms like tree trunks from working out after work. He had arms like tree trunks, tattoos from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. He goes, this tough guy goes to Paul, what must I do to be saved? Get me here. Believe on the Lord Jesus. You will be saved, you and your household. Wow. The Gospel of John takes the most fancy and highbrow philosophies, and it always just puts it real simple for people like us. Believe on Jesus. Believe on Jesus. It says all the fancy philosophies, all the this and that, and it just puts it in a way so you and I can understand it. It says, believe on Jesus. There's the ticket. The key to heaven was hung on a nail. Amen? First Easter sermon ever preached to you. Have an Easter faith in a Good Friday world. Have an Easter faith in my Good Friday world. And one of our first Good Friday services, one of my brother pastors from the AME church, he preached this. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. And it is Sunday right now. What can we learn on this resurrection morning? The Easter Sunday after Good Friday? We can learn the worst thing is never the last thing. God's answer to death is resurrection. Jesus rising transforms our sorrow into joy, our fear into peace and courage. Remember that acronym I gave you? I learned it just recently. Fear. Forget everything and run. Who's ever done that? I've done that. Forget everything and run. Or fear. Face everything and rise. That's what Jesus Christ does. We call it Holy Week. And that's what he wants his followers to do. That's what he wants. That's his plan for our lives. To face everything and rise. In the Gospel of John, between Jesus and John, 47 times, they use the word life or eternal life. 47 times. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, put them together, they don't mention it that many times. 47 times, John and Jesus and John talk about life and eternal life. John 14:19, a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live, you also will live. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in us this morning. 14:20. On that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Life now. Life right now. Glimpses of glory. The author of our Bible study, his name is Adam Hamilton. Got a church in the Midwest. When I think about the problems that face our world, I believe that so many would be resolved if people practiced what Jesus taught. If they actually loved one another. If they saw greatness in servanthood, let me be last. If they showed compassion, told the truth, practiced forgiveness, stopped judging, loved their enemy. In our first study in the Gospel of John, Jesus turns water into wine. Real quick, when I do a wedding, I love to tell the story. Grandfather takes his kid to Sunday school. The kid comes out of Sunday school and says, "Hey, what'd you learn?" He said, "Jesus turned the water into wine." And Grandpa says, "So what does that mean?" He said, "If you want to have a wedding, make sure Jesus is there." In the Methodist church, then we turn it into grape juice. Amen. Good stuff. Help us, Jesus. You know, Jesus' mother said something to the servants that day. Do what he tells you to do. To have life in Jesus, to believe on his name. Servants of God, word from the Lord. Do what he tells you to do. Wow. Love your enemies. Love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples. If you have love for one another. Love one another as I have loved you. Wow, pretty tall order. He just went to the cross for us. Wow. And then eternal life. When we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be. That's truly the last word. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. The stories we hear of people who have gone to heaven and their loved ones are waiting for them. And then sometimes I heard a story recently where Jesus said to the person, "There are so many people praying for you right now, I gotta send you back." Amen. On this Easter Sunday, Friday is still very much a part of life. ISIS, Brussels, all I have to say is just a couple words and you know I'm talking Friday. But there's a call on each of our lives to have an Easter faith in a Good Friday world. Have an Easter faith in a Good Friday world. There's a call on each of our lives. And if Jesus were to write a prescription for each of us, he'd hand it to us and it would be, what's the work of you? What are we supposed to do? Believe in the one whom he has sent. Believe in Jesus and have life. Believe in the Lord Jesus. Through believing, you may have life in his name. The same power that raised Jesus up is at work in our lives and in our relationships and in our hearts. And in our homes, and in our church, even here, right now. The call to live the resurrection. It's how I saw my name. You know, years ago, I saw people sign their name like this, if they put a sign of the cross. Then, like 4 or 5 Easters ago, God said to me, that ain't the end of the story. Or maybe God said to me, that isn't the end of the story. So I draw a little empty tomb. He is not here. He is risen. There's more to the story than the cross. But there's no resurrection without the cross. There's no resurrection. And sometimes they're little crosses and sometimes they're mighty big. And to understate, we do not love perfectly That's why we have to have this forgiveness thing. This reset button that God gives us. No, I didn't get it right. But I want to get it right. Amen. What does living the resurrection look like in the disciples' lives? The original disciples. I think there's some clues for us. They're real. They're real. You know, I'm not sad that Peter denied Jesus 3 times. I'm kind of glad it happened. And I think in Peter's life it was kind of good it happened. Because he realized how bankrupt he was, and he realized how much he needed Jesus. And the same guy who denied Jesus 3 times, God uses him to lead 3,000 people to him. See the difference? Like, hey, I can do it. You see the difference between, hey, I can do it and living a surrendered life is? I can't do it without you, God. They're real. They're ordinary people who God uses in an extraordinary way. You know, like the story I told on Holy Thursday night. You know, the hand grenades are sitting there. Michael Mansour, he had 2 choices. He could have gone that way, away from the hand grenades, or he could have gone that way, which is on top of the hand grenades, which he chose and saved many lives. God blesses us. Pastor Tristan, the guy over at Bethany Lutheran Church, we had a great Good Friday breakfast, Good Friday morning, and he was on a trip with a bunch of seminary students over in Cambodia and Laos and Vietnam, and they were gonna, last part of the trip, they were gonna take a quick plane ride, and you know, they just, all of a sudden they heard somebody making wells, and hey, let's take the bus instead, and you know, nothing was coming out of their pocket, he said, so why don't we just give that money to the well people? So they're in a bus, they're just driving around, and they end up on this back street, this backwoods. It's dark at night. It's like, why are we going here? And they go, and all of a sudden they get out, and there's this little sign that says, thank you to the students from Lutheran Theological Seminary for our well. And this sweet lady is there pumping a well, and she now can make a meal and have clean water for her kids. And Tristan said they cried. And then Tristan said, it was like God said to him, I'm calling you into ministry. You see, the risen Christ is live television. He's live television. He's real. He wants us to take the crosswalk like the disciples. How do you know it's the crosswalk? I can't do this without you, Lord. I need your help. That's the crosswalk, where you see the shadow of the cross and you know that you know that you need God. The disciples then, the disciples now. They make a difference. And sometimes you don't even know it's happening. And then one night in the middle of the night, you show up and you didn't realize it, but you helped somebody to build a well. Or somebody says to you, you know, when you encouraged me, you really blessed me. When you smiled, you don't know what that meant to me. God is so good. What will living the resurrection look like in your life? What will it look like in my life? That's the question. What will do what he tells you to do look like in your life? Twice this week, I knew exactly where I was going. I knew what I was doing. I knew what I was going to say. And twice this week, God cut me off at the knees and said, no, that's not what you're doing. God, don't stop doing that. Because living the resurrected life, live television. What will it look like in your life? What will it look like in our hearts? What will it look like in our homes? What will it look like in the body of Christ? Buckle your seatbelts. God has a plan for each of us, for His church. Go, God, go. Please pray with me. Lord, thank you for the resurrection. Thank you, Jesus Christ, for the resurrection. Thank you for everything in your word. Thank you for the way that the disciples are real, even with their failures. Sometimes even especially with their failures. Thank you, Lord, that you help us to take the crosswalk. You'll even hold our hand and live inside of us when we take the crosswalk. We love you, Lord. And thank you, Lord, for the excitement and the adventure of what you are doing. Thank you for resurrection. And be with us, Lord, we pray, in the Good Fridays, the Holy Saturdays. And please, while on others thou art calling, do not pass us by. And all God's people say,
amen.
Hey, please stand with me. We have an Easter response. Please stand. And, you know, nobody's going to be looking at you. But if you need a special touch from God this morning, just lift up your hand somehow, some way, so that God knows that you need it.